Hey everyone, this is Brett Hancock. This is kind of an unusual way that I'm making videos, but that's okay. I was talking to some brothers and sisters today, and there seems to be a lot of confusion about what Matthew 5:31, 32, or particularly verse 32 is talking about with regard to, you know, a quote-unquote exception or exception clause, or even using the word except, and really what that's all about. So I'm just going to throw a real quick video here, upload it. Hopefully it helps you. But let's dispel some of the misunderstanding and rumors. So I'm going to start out reading verse 31, and we'll look at verse 32. So Jesus is distinguishing between what Moses said in Deuteronomy chapter 24, first three verses, contains this information in verse 31, and distinguishing between what Jesus is doing all through this Sermon on the Mount. He's like, you've heard it said of old, pointing to 1,500 years before, but I say to you, right? And in contrast, we're changing it here, right? And that's why he introduced the Sermon on the Mount with, like, hey, I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to fulfill it. So what he's doing is he's bringing to pass all the prophecies about him in the Old Testament, and he is changing things, but it's through the fulfillment that brings the change. And that's why Hebrews chapter 7 and 8 said that the law was abrogated. And then, then he uses the whole prophecy in Psalms 110 about him being the priest in the order of Melchizedek, and how Moses had never talked about there being somebody from the tribe of Judah, but, you know, talked about the priest from Levi, you know, Levitical priesthood and that tribe from Levi and everything or whatever. So anyway, this video is not about that. This is about Matthew 5, 31, 32. So let's get into that. So verse 31 says, further, it has been said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you, right? That's what Jesus keeps saying throughout the Sermon on the Mount. But I say to you. In contrast, in other words, but I say to you, whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality causes her, here's the key word, this is the key, this is the whole theme of verse 32, it's a cause. Okay, is the wife the cause, or is the husband the cause? And the turning point, the predicator on that, that determines that, the determinator of that, is whether she commits sexual sin or not. If she's committing sexual sin, well, yeah, she's causing her own adultery, right? If she's not committing sexual sin, and the husband says, you know what, for whatever, Jesus didn't even give any reason. He just said, any reason, right? He said, that's what he says. But I say to you, whoever divorces his wife for any reason, right, except that she's guilty of sexual sin, he's the cause for any reason other than that. He's the cause. And that's what this verse is all about, for her committing adultery. So she goes and remarries, she's committing adultery. If she goes next door and sleeps with somebody, you know, without getting married, she's committing adultery. If she's lusting after somebody, he just introduced that few verses before that. It could imply that, because that specifically is talking about if a man looks at a woman, he lusts after her. But in any case, any kind of adultery, I mean, he's putting pressure on her, basically, to commit adultery. And, you know, most likely he's talking about remarriage. That's most likely what he's saying. But that's what he's saying. If he kicks her to the curb for any reason other than her already committing sexual sin, then he will be guilty of causing her to commit adultery. So the implication is, and the whole New Testament says that the husband has the responsibility for the wife, right? Because even in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, it says that the woman can stay separated from her husband. It says she shouldn't, right? But if she does, she must remain alone, right? There's nowhere in the New Testament says the husband can do that. In fact, this verse right here says he better not do that unless she's committing sexual sin. Because if she goes off and remarries, or she goes in any case, commits adultery, he's going to be to blame. So he cannot remain alone, right? Unless she's committing porneia. So anyway, so verse 32, let's look at it again. But I say to you that whoever divorces his wife for any reason except sexual immorality or porneia or fornication causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a woman that is, who is divorced commits adultery. So we're not going to focus on that last part. This third party guy that comes along and, you know, picks her up and says, oh, she's divorced, let me remarry her. We're not going to focus on that. We're going to back up and we're going to look just at that first clause of verse 32 of that sentence, right? It says, but I say to you that any husband, okay, let's put it into words of what he's really saying. Any husband that divorces his wife any wife that divorces his wife, he causes her to commit adultery unless the wife is committing porneia. That's what he's saying. So again, this is all about the guilt, the cause of adultery. And, you know, if she's committing sexual sin, she's guilty. If she's not committing sexual sin and he cuts her free and says, look, you know, I'm out of here, or you got to go get out of here, she's like putting pressure. He's putting pressure on her. He's like, man, I got kids. I got to get married because I can't survive, right? And I'm sure back then that was a very common occurrence. Nowadays, not so much, but still, even so, still, it's still the case. I mean, the scriptures are timeless, right? In any case, he's putting pressure on her to go and get remarried, which is committing adultery if she's not already committing sexual sin. So anyway, I hope that clears some things up and helps you. All right, God bless you.